All right, let's call Gabe Hoffman.
Hello?
Hey, buddy, it's AJ.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm doing well, man. I'm doing well. I'm glad you had time to talk today.
No worries.
Thanks for making time for us. My listeners know about you. They know about the movie, An Open Secret. They've been told to watch it repeatedly. And as I've always said, your movie is responsible, I think, for this show turning a corner and becoming something entirely different than I thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be about a scandal every week, and it turned into me just kind of dissolving everything that goes on in this town and riffing on it. And the majority of the stuff that's happened since September, although it goes way back, but from September on, it's been nothing but these sexual misdeeds and pedophilia. And do you have any hope that things are getting better? Tell me.
Well, I gotta thank you for all that, AJ. I appreciate that, and even you know was listening to your last show about that. I would tell you that as far as the you got to separate it into two categories, right? There's the sort of adult stuff, which is mostly you know Me Too, where it's sexual assault or you know rape against women, and that's obviously terrible stuff. And then the other thing is the kid stuff. With the Me Too stuff, we're probably at least halfway through it, maybe a little more. Unfortunately, with the kids stuff, yes, we've heard, you know, obviously things about 8 kids coming out and saying that serial, you know, molester Gary Goddard, who's not a name people would know, but a big producer and big, has a big company that does a lot of, you know, theme parks and things like that. You had 7 or so about the big agent Tyler Grasham. Again, a name you wouldn't know, but reps a lot of young talent in this town. You've heard a few others, Kevin Spacey, you know, attraction to underage. Mm-hmm. But the kid stuff is just tougher. It's not as easy structurally for the reporters, the journalists who are doing great work to really get after. And, right. and Ronan Farrow even talked about that a little bit. So that's coming. It was the cycle in the British press. It took years and years. And I think every, you know, month or two, you're going to hear about a new underage thing for quite some time, unfortunately.
You know, you're right. And I bumped into Ronan at the Beverly Hills Hotel last week, and I immediately said, look, you surprised me with the last story. You had us all thinking it was going to be a big pedophile expose. I thought he was going to nail Dan Schneider, which a lot of people... Dan Schneider is one of those names that many people didn't know anything about less than a year ago. And suddenly, with what you've done, with what I'm doing, with what Crazy Days and Nights has done and a number of other websites... That guy has become a household name for creeps, but yet he's still around. I don't know what it's going to take to knock these guys down.
It's funny. A lot of people were getting kind of excited about that, and I was trying to, you know, tamp it down, not that I had any inside information, but mm-hmm. I said, I was thinking, look, there's no way that Ronan's next piece could be about Dan Schneider simply because he hasn't called me, and he would have if he was
that's
doing
good.
It.
Yeah, that's
because he's
true.
Such a great reporter.
Yep, you're right. You're right about that. Yeah, you know, and it's hard. Your life has changed dramatically. I don't think before you produced An Open Secret, I don't think you were doing much in the way of searching or outing pedophiles or doing any kind of work like that, were you?
Not at all. I had a nice, normal life. I grew up in southern New Jersey,
right.
Outside of Philadelphia and Cherry Hill. You know, thank God.
Sure.
A nice, normal childhood.
Yeah.
And about 5 years ago, my buddy from NYU, Matt Valentinus, who is co-producer of An Open Secret, he had worked in Hollywood on the business side, Sony Pictures, as a lawyer for about 10 years, and he pitched me with this idea, knowing that I had done the hedge fund stuff and continue to do it. It's my day job. I was the youngest hedge fund manager on Wall Street back in 2000 at age 23 and still going strong, and he knew that I could support a kind of social project, and that was the idea. Is Matt told me, look, he felt that there was a big child sex abuse problem in Hollywood, really hadn't, no documentary ever been done. I kind of wasn't looking to do a documentary, so I said, show me the proof. And Matt came up with a great plan. And the plan was this: put up about $100,000, which is real money, but,
right.
you know, it's not much, and just get the research done. And he connected us with Disarming Films, the film company, Amy Berg's company, that had done. And she'd gotten an Oscar nomination for Deliver Us From Evil about the Catholic Church a few years earlier.
Right.
And we hired private investigators on our own to supplement that. The research came back a few months later, and as you know from the film, it was just mind-boggling. And when I saw all this on my desk, yeah, have to write the check and do the film.
Sure.
So it was more of just like in investing in stocks, you try to figure out the future. This was more making a social investment and try to be ahead of the curve there. And mm-hmm. I guess that worked out, unfortunately.
Well, it certainly did. Is there any plans, or have you been approached at all to do a part two or another kind of deep dive into pedophilia in the business as a film?
I would just say that we haven't been out looking to do stuff. With that said, there's probably about 12 hours of footage from the full interviews from An Open Secret that we could release at any time. There's also, you know, and I guess it's more of a trust that we've earned. It's not something that we asked for, but people have approached us with, you know, stories of being abused and things like that. And we've made connections sometimes behind the scenes in vetting stories and things and finding, you know, good journalists who are willing to tackle it. And sometimes less behind the scenes, like the big Deadline Hollywood story about Bryan Singer's former teen lover that was written by Dawn Chmielewski, who was in our film, and that was in early December. And that's really a big piece. And you can read some of the things in there, read between the lines, and, you know, think that there's probably more to come on that front.
Well, that's great because, man, it seems to be everywhere. And I don't know what's happened to me, but I think I'm not alone. Everything I read now, I just feel like it's running parallel with the whole pedophilia problem in this industry. It makes you go, well, it's not just this industry. It's in every walk of life is a problem. I saw a great documentary a few nights ago, Call Me Lucky, the Barry Crimmon story, Barry the great comic who just passed away. You must have. I didn't know about that documentary until he passed. Did you know about that beforehand?
No, my partner on the film, Matt, did. I certainly didn't. But you look at the work just in reading about it, that he did in the 90s and went to Congress about how all those AOL, you know, chat rooms in the early days of the internet were basically, you know, for pedophile fishing and just full of them. And that brings us to, you know, what we can do today, because you probably just saw there was a big, you know, story. It's not just USA Girls Gymnastics.
Oh, I know.
It's not just the Catholic Church, and it's not just schools. Just another story. The most powerful girls volleyball coach in the United States,
I know,
was just sued for raping six girls over a period of years.
Yeah.
The wife knew, and there were a ton of complaints, and he just got, you know, basically shuttled around all the time, shifted from place to place. It's something that's truly horrific. So, yeah, to your point, it really requires something systemic to address in America. We do have, you know, something that happened in the UK and something that happened in Australia, which are national commissions. And, you know, that's something we can talk about that we're looking forward to.
Jeez. You know, I wondered if, and you don't have to answer this if I get too close to some stuff that I know you keep very private, but, you know, a long time ago, Corey Feldman said the one person to blame in the death of Corey Haim is a Hollywood mogul. And I'm not going to be the one to put that person's name out. Take that, and then also couple that with a lot of these blinds we read on Crazy Days and Nights, which is a site I love to go to. But I'm getting confused. If people know of someone specifically doing something illegal with a person underage, don't they have a legal right, let alone a moral right, to come forward and show the police this person did this? These blinds are driving me. It feels like icky. We need to get more dirt and go forward and get police on us.
Well, you're right, and there's a lot of structural issues with that. There are some states, it's a patchwork of law state by state, and okay, fine, we're a federal republic of states. Not everything is to the federal government, but individual, you know, states have been around for 100 or 200 years. Things need to be updated. We realize this is a bigger problem than it used to be. And so it really takes, and they had, you know, they call it Royal Commission in the UK or in Great Britain. In America, it would be a presidential commission, and only the president has the power to call it, to bring together states, local, federal, talk about things that go into this problem, like mandatory reporting requirements for it could be educational or sports or entertainment in large organizations, funding for mandatory minimum sentences to actually lock up these child molesters for what society judges are reasonable periods of time. Things like the statute of limitations, where, if, for example, Gary Glitter, the big rocker in the UK, right. You know, he got locked up for doing things recently, for doing things to kids in the 70s and 80s.
Yeah.
Because, and they changed the laws there so that even you're an adult today, you know, and you've got, look, six now adults, they're all telling the same story, the same grooming and things like that. And their names were still able to be shielded from the public. They weren't shielded in court, but from the public. And that's also a really important thing, because if you're talking about somebody who's 35, 40 years old, they've got a wife and kids, they're not a public person, but they're going after somebody who's important.
Right.
How can you, you know, strike the right balance? And I think they've done that very well in those countries, but it truly takes a national commission to bring a couple dozen of those leaders all together. I mean, AJ, imagine a world where you could send your kid to look up a sporting organization or, you know, an entertainment organization or a school. And just like you have, for example, in environmental stuff, you have LEED, where something is LEED gold. And if you want to rent office space in a building or buy a house, you can tell it's LEED gold or LEED silver. And, you know, those are voluntary,
right.
But there's a set of standards.
Right.
Imagine if there was a kid safe standard. I'm just making up a name, but
sure.
There was some standard where a group would say, yes, we comply with such and such standard, and you would know, okay, that means that if there's a report of something, that how it gets passed along and what they do about it, and you could look those things up and it would be transparent.
Sure, that's great. Look, we have grades of meat that we buy, you know. There's basically grades on everything, but not on kids. I've often said, or at least once or twice on this show, that I've been on movie sets and I've seen animals, or not even cute animals, treated better or tended to more than children. You looked after. I'm sure it's changed now. I haven't been on a film set in over 10 years on a big film. I'm sure it's better now, but there was a time where, you know, the kids were kind of on their own and things happen and people look the other way. But you're doing something that I want to get to with this petition with Donald Trump. We need 100,000 signatures on this Presidential Commission on Child Sex Abuse in America. Now, when did you start this? You started sending this away like a few weeks ago, right?
A couple days ago, now. You have the rules are like this. For us, it's by March 23rd.
Okay.
You need 100,000 signatures in 30 days. Mm. Now, yes, to click a retweet takes a second. To actually go to the website through the link that we have, either on our Twitter at An Open Secret, on Facebook and Open Secret, or just the White House petition website and scroll down and you'll see it. Yeah, it takes a minute to register and put in your email address and get registered and actually sign the thing. But it's the only structural solution. It's not political. We have people like Rosanna Arquette, and we have Jake Austin, and we have Corey Feldman. We have prominent liberals and conservatives who recognize that this is the only structural solution. Only a presidential commission, like in the UK and Australia, can call all these different parties together that we're talking about to come up with real solutions across the country and make big change.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not political at all. Only the president can call a presidential commission. And if you get the 100,000 signatures in 30 days, by law, you have to get a yes or no answer.
Right.
It would probably be the most popular thing President Trump ever did.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And I would just, it's funny, but I would add, right now, today, there's over 130,000 signatures on a petition calling for him to resign at the White House website. Just a total waste of time.
Oh,
clearly,
my
he's
God.
Not going to do that.
Yeah.
So if that many people can get together for things that they know are a waste of time and not do anything,
yeah,
we should be able to get, with everyone's help, 100,000 for something that could truly change a major issue in America.
Absolutely. Listen, I know the Oscars are going off in a few hours. Jimmy Kimmel could change everything if he opened the show telling people to do exactly what we just said, to go sign this petition. But he won't. He'll spend the first 12 minutes trashing Trump. But if he only did that, you'd have that. We'd reach 100,000 in about 5 minutes. Do you know what number we're at? Is there a way to check?
We're at a few thousand now. We definitely need to push it. The interesting thing is, you talk about the award shows, and at the Golden Globes, the only mention of child sex abuse in Hollywood and just the total epidemic. The only mention was when host Seth Meyers told a couple sick Kevin Spacey jokes.
Right. You're exactly right. And I give credit to the artist Sabo. I don't know how he pronounces his name. But you folks not living in L.A., the intersection of Wilshire and La Brea are very popular in town if you're an actor or in the business. Put up three billboards. One said in the Oscar for the biggest pedophile goes to. The other one said we all know and still no arrest. And the third one said name names on stage or shut the hell up. No one's going to say anything tonight, but I'm glad this artist brought some attention to it. Do you know the artist at all or no?
I've heard of him.
Yeah.
He's definitely well known. And they also, there was another big piece of street art that you probably saw, the Harvey Weinstein
yes.
on a couch.
Yes.
And his color was in the same, they colored it the same color as the Oscar statue.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing is that particular street artist is the same one who did the naked Donald Trumps.
Right.
So it tells you that the hatred and the derision for Hollywood's hypocrisy is truly a bipartisan issue.
Of course it is. And we've got to all listen. I've got all my listeners to go to. They can go to The Open Secret on Twitter. You can go to your Facebook page and do it. It's not hard to find. But just sign the damn petition to appoint a presidential commission on child sex abuse in America. I know I've talked about it, and I'm going to keep talking about it on this show. But real quick, before I let you go, are there last week, I think I mentioned Brian Peck, the dialogue coach who was found, you know, who did some time for doing inappropriate shit to a kid. And I mentioned he was a dialogue coach on Two and a Half Men. I actually should have said it was Anger Management. Wrong show, but still the same creep. Any word on him or anybody that we're also tailing? We talk about, I think a few weeks ago I mentioned something about who's the creep that came back on the news? He's kind of getting a new image from some PR firm.
Brock Pierce, the Bitcoin
Brock
guy.
Brock Pierce, the Bitcoin guy, which is always a shadowy place to have a life. There's a lot of things you can hide being a Bitcoin guy. But yeah, so Brock Pierce is getting like a new varnish on him. Anybody else you see that happening to that you got your eye on?
We'll see how long Brock Pierce's thing lasts. I have a feeling it won't last very long without tipping anything off.
Okay.
But there are so many. What we're really focused on is, you know, outing new pedophiles, so to speak, or outing, you know, misbehavior with young and vulnerable people. Now, I know that, you know, you're a master and a lot of your listeners are of kind of in the podcast format of short stories.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you're interested, but there are two very short stories about Hollywood and how things work and what sort of happened with the film that you might find interesting.
Sure.
In each about 2 or 3 minutes.
Go ahead. Sure. Yeah.
So one thing is, and you remember from our film, that we actually unmask on camera a pedophile. Someone admits to inappropriate behavior with children named Michael Hara.
Yeah.
What you don't know is the following. So SAG-AFTRA is, for people who don't know, it's the biggest union in Hollywood. It's got over 100,000 members. It's nationwide. And I'm sure you got a SAG-AFTRA card. You have to have one
sure,
to work.
Sure.
Ronald Reagan was once the president of SAG.
Mm-hmm.
And so this interview took place, obviously, during filming. Nobody knew we were making the film. It was kept very hush-hush. What people don't know is, so Michael Hara was on this committee within SAG called the Young Performers Committee, just like most big organizations have a lot of different committees to do a lot of different things.
Right.
And the Young Performers Committee, which Michael Hara had been on for decades as one of the most prominent child scouts and managers of the last 30, 40 years, the Young Performers Committee's sole job is to protect children.
Mm-hmm.
The research indicated he, you know, might be a pedophile.
Mm.
And so an interview was held. Well, at that interview, what you don't see on camera is that SAG-AFTRA had a press person with them at the time.
Mm-hmm.
So this press person sees this interview and goes back to SAG-AFTRA and tells them what happened. So the real thing, AJ, is what does SAG-AFTRA do? I mean, you'd think they might call us and ask us to see the tape,
right?
Or they might like call us and say thank you or something.
Mm-hmm.
That's not what they did at all. They quietly let Michael Hara resign.
Jesus.
They didn't send out any kind of email or bulletin to members saying, look, if your kid worked with Michael Hara, you know, come contact if we have a tape you need to see, something like that. No thank you to us. In fact, what they did is their president sent us a letter threatening to sue us if we identified him by his proper identification as being a member of the Young Performers Committee. So we told them no. Deadline Hollywood wrote a story on it back then. David Robb wrote a story. People can see it. Of course, then SAG responded, and they lied about the threat that they had made to us. So David Robb published a follow-up story with the actual letter to show what they lied about. And so what's really interesting is, has SAG-AFTRA changed anything today? If you found a pedophile in SAG-AFTRA now in a position of prominence, what would they do about it? Would they tell anybody, or would they let them quietly resign and try to cover it up?
Unbelievable, man. I don't know. A lot of things have to change. A lot of things have to change. I know we're going in the right direction. A lot of that thanks has to go to you. You're going to be a guy that I bring on this show quite a bit. I don't know if you're ever out in L.A. Do you get out here much or no?
I should be out there in about the next month.
All right.
And to do some things, and I would love to.
Oh, yeah.
So, real quick, the second little anecdote.
Oh, yeah, sure.
So have you heard of the big attorney Michael Donaldson?
No.
He's probably on every power list of big attorneys. Okay. He's represented, in Hollywood, represented Oliver Stone, Leo DiCaprio, Clive Davis, the big music mogul,
right.
The Geffen Playhouse, which is David Geffen Theater.
Sure.
And so it turns out that Michael Donaldson represents somebody named Randall Kleiser, which is not a name that I really know.
Yeah.
Turns out that Randall Kleiser was the director of Grease.
Oh.
The big blockbuster iconic film with John Travolta and all,
right?
Right. So that was in 1978. Randall Kleiser, I didn't know this. It turns out his career took a bit of a tumble because in 1999, he was directing Royal Standard for Den Digital Entertainment Network, that big front for pedophiles.
The front, shows. Right.
And Royal Standard was the show that Nick S. from our film in Open Secret was getting raped by the head pedophile Mark Collins Rector on.
Jesus.
So Randall Kleiser is in the trailer for our film for about two seconds. Mm-hmm. That's it. Mm-hmm. And one day in 2015, after our trailer's out, we get an email and then a phone call from Michael Donaldson of, Donaldson Califf. It's his firm, one of the biggest out there.
I mean, right.
That's a name that if you hear, like, you're quaking in your boots, right?
Sure.
It turns out that our partner, Matt Valentinus, a co-producer, he's a lawyer by trade, so he's got, the little Esquire after his name. And I guess Michael Donaldson miscalculated, thought that, this person he didn't know was really the attorney for the film, and maybe we didn't know what we were doing. So he contacted us, asked who our attorney is, and we told him it's Chuck Greenberg at Greenberg Lusker, which is also a big attorney, very well respected.
Right.
And then he had threatened to sue us if we didn't take his client, Randall Kleiser, out of the 2 seconds of of the little trailer. Well, my answer was, wow, there's another Hollywood big shot that I didn't even know about that's in my film.
Jesus.
So I'm going to throw a name tag on him, and I'm going to tell everybody that he's in there. So I went on the Ben Shapiro show that afternoon.
Great.
It's a big, big radio show out there.
Sure.
And the Hollywood Reporter wrote about it, and the quote that Michael Donaldson gave was that nobody will watch the film anyway.
Yeah, well,
I guess after we released it for free and over 4 million people have seen it in 4 months and nobody ever sued us, I guess he was wrong about that too.
Perfect. I love stories like that. They're like rats, and we got to get them. They're like roaches. They're like rats. And we're setting some big traps, buddy. And I love to hear your stories. When you come out to L.A., you're going to come sit with me. We'll do this in person. Okay, pal?
That's awesome.
All right, my friend.
You're doing great work, AJ. Thanks much.
Thanks, buddy. Talk to you soon. Take care. Okay, Gabe Hoffman, man. That guy knows his shit. I don't think he ever thought his life would be this way, from running a hedge fund to stamping out pedophiles all over the industry. Hey, it's great. We need guys like that. One last bit about the Oscars. If you've ever wondered how real the shock and surprise is on some of the winners' and losers' faces, let me lay this story on you. Many years ago, an actress named Carrie Snodgrass knocked the shit out of a film role in a movie called Diary of a Mad Housewife. You got to go find that somewhere and see it, okay? She was like a fucking tornado in this movie. She won all the awards leading up, even the Golden Globe. She even won something called New Star of the Year. But at the time, she was dating the rock star Neil Young. And what she loved more than anything else was to hang with Neil Young and his friends, have barbecues, get stoned, drink some drinks, and not really give a shit about Hollywood, and also care for their son, who was born with palsy. Carrie was my acting coach for a while out here in L.A. for a couple of roles I was getting ready for, and she was fierce and loved to tell hard truths. She told me she wasn't planning on going to the Oscars when she was nominated for Diary of a Mad Housewife, but she was getting calls from influential Hollywood people telling her to go, but she kept turning them down. Then one day, in the middle of a sunny afternoon in Northern California, a helicopter landed in a field adjacent to the big property that Neil Young owned, and out of the helicopter walks Charlton Heston, who at the time was the president of the Screen Actors Guild. And Heston greets everybody there, a bunch of rockers who are stoned and drinking. And he basically says to Carrie, "I'm here to tell you, you should go to the Oscars. You need to go to the Oscars." She's like, "I really don't want to go." And he says, "I need to tell you that winning an Oscar is contingent upon you being there. No show, no Oscar." And then Charlton Heston thanked Neil Young, but mistakenly said to him, "I've always been a fan of your music, Mr. Diamond. I love Cracklin' Rosie." The idiot confused the rocker for the pop star, Neil Diamond. So Neil Young tells Carrie, "You do what you want, baby, but that's one dumb motherfucker." So Carrie Snodgrass never went to the Oscars. And that night, the award went to Glenda Jackson. And Carrie's career suffered because of it. She was actually cast as Adrian in Rocky, but word came down from someone that she's too difficult, and she was fired. And one day, while she was coaching me, Carrie said to me, "I want more than anything to outlive that cocksucker Chuck Heston, so I can tell everybody what really happened to me and why I didn't win that damned Oscar, because I was better than all of them that year." Sadly, Carrie didn't outlive Heston. She died in 2004. He died in 2008. But here I am in 2018, giving my acting coach's words some meaning. Finally, I'm AJ Benza, and that was Fame is a Bitch.
Hey, before you go, we wanted to let you know that we just launched the ability for anyone to advertise on podcasts. You're just a few clicks away from reaching millions of people in a way that you never have before. Advertise for a business, event, or kick off an awareness campaign for your brand. Start today at purewinning.com/CNN. Integrating podcasts into your marketing mix has never been easier. Go to purewinning.com/CNN to get started.